Hello team. Привет. Привет. Happy to meet you here in Meissen, in this special place. Do you remember how many trips you have made to Meissen?
I don't think so. But let me see, I've been coming here for 12 years, maybe 14 years, something like that. So many trips, almost every year I've been coming here, practicing with Guruji first and Sharad, and then later when after Guruji died, coming and practicing with Sharad. And also Saraswati, of course.
I see, thank you. And I have a question about teaching. I'm interested, how did you start to teach others? How did you feel you ready, or how it happened with you?
Yeah, it kind of just happened. It was a coincidence. I actually never intended to become a yoga teacher, but life somehow moved me in that direction. I came from dance. I was using the practice to be strong in my body for dancing. And then slowly some friends asked, please help us, we're going out of town, can you substitute this class? And I helped a little bit here and there. And then later I moved to Miami, and there's the same thing happened. I didn't have anything to do, and a friend said, we have Mysore program, we have no teacher, will you please come and teach this program? And I said, okay, I'll try. So I started teaching, and it was very nerve-wracking for me because I was not used to Sanskrit, and I had to call to Samastitihi and say the opening invocation. So every time I did that, I was sweating so much. But I was quite comfortable working with other people's bodies and stuff, so that was not so scary for me. It was just a little bit new language. But as I had been practicing for many years already, it was not so scary.
Oh, thank you. And about morning Mysore program, next question. There is a widespread belief that when practitioner starts to teach others, it negatively affects his own practice because he have to share his big part of his energy with students. Is it from your experience, or do you think possible to find right balance between own practice and teaching students? How it's from your experience?
I think ideally it is an organic process where we practice for so long, so there becomes a need around us, in the community around us, to share the information that we are beginning to embody, that we are beginning to understand, and that it's an organic process to start to share a little bit more of what it is that we do. If it happens in this manner, then also the body is strong, the mind is strong, and there's no pretension. We're just simply almost not teaching, we just allow other people into what we are doing. I think that is the best way to do it. And when the practice is strong, when the practitioner is seasoned, then the information flow very easy. And the practitioner has the physical, the spiritual, the energetic capacity to be with other people, so you don't get so tired. But often if we start out, if we open our own shala, something like that, then there's so much work, so it's hard to get on the mat. But I think that is the same thing if you become a mother, or if you get a new job or something like that. It's hard to fit everything into a day. So therefore, commitment must already be there. If no commitment is there, it's not possible.
I'd like to ask you about the balance of proper alignment and natural course of events in the practice. I mean that as Westerners we tend to put too much attention into alignment, and as far as I understand, Sharadji doesn't really like it. So how do you find balance in your own practice and while teaching others in that?
I think it is important to keep in mind what yoga is really about. I think it's important to remember that the asana practice is a method, that the asana is a method towards beginning to understand who we are, beginning to understand what the world is about, beginning to understand what our role in the world is, and so forth, in that way that it becomes a true sadhana, that it becomes a spiritual practice, one that raises our spirit up. Now along the way, because these asanas are not so easy, and they take lots of effort, lots of strength, lots of flexibility, I think it is important to learn a little bit about how this instrument works. Now, if we choose to use the body as the instrument towards understanding of self, a higher consciousness, something like that, then I think it's important that we also take a look at how the body works. And when we start to look at how the body works, then we're talking anatomy, we're talking physiology, we're talking pathology, and we are also talking about technique. I think, in my opinion, technique is important to the degree where we can use it so we don't hurt ourselves. We can use it in a way so we don't get in our own way. If I know how my hip joint work, then it's easier to put my legs in Padmasana. If I don't know how the hip joint work, then I might try to go into Padmasana in a way which doesn't correspond with how the body is built. So if we know basic constructional information about the body, we can make sure not to get injured, and we can make sure to take the path of least resistance. Of course, then we can get very obsessed with details. And in my opinion, this is what I think Sharad is talking about. He says, you get too obsessed with these details, all you think about is the body. Please also think about God when you practice.
How do you learn or study the inner paths and other limbs of yoga? Do you read or do you practice any kind of meditation or whatever? And how do you teach others as well, if you do so?
So for the first years of doing Ashtanga yoga, I was very interested in asana. It was very much fun. I was a younger man. It was fun to learn to do Kalandavasana. It was fun to learn to bend my back, you know, all and jump back and forward. It was fantastic for some years like that. Then after that, I start to think, what else is there? Now I can do this, what else is there? So from there, I start to read more books. And then the books were kind of difficult to understand. The Bhagavad Gita is hard to understand. I did not speak any Sanskrit, so all these sounds were very intriguing to me. So I started to have a curiosity towards that. And I started to have some experiences inside of me that required some type of inquiry into more than just the body, into maybe spirit or energy and so forward. So I began to study with some of the magnificent teachers of philosophy that you can find here in Mysore, India. Try to understand what is Patanjali meaning when he's in his Yoga Sutras is talking about what yoga is and how it works and what the benefits is and where it all leads to and so forth. How does it correspond with what Arjuna and Krishna is talking about in the Bhagavad Gita? And in the journey of that, I realized that I need to read some other text which is foundational for understanding what Patanjali says and so forth. So that took me on a whole journey which I'm still on.
Can you recommend several books for reading for the beginners, for example? I mean, for people who practice like 1-2 years to start with?
I think there is some very important primary texts that we should all read. And I think we don't need to rush to read them, but I think we need to read them. I think that the basic paradigm within which yoga exists is very well described and very beautifully described in the Bhagavad Gita the Divine Song, which is a very famous book, the most sold book in the whole world. That's a wonderful story about a warrior that is sent out to war, and then he doubts that actually he should fight or if he should not fight. And then his good friend and a divine being, Krishna, is being sent down to him to advise him. So the whole book is in a dialogue format where God, so to speak, a divine figure, comes down to help a small human being take care of his problems. So that's a wonderful book to do. A book that is talking a little bit about same things as Patanjali Yoga Sutras. It's much more technical and much more difficult to understand. So if you're interested in math and science, that's an interesting book. If you're not so interested in that, then maybe wait a little bit with that. And then again, I think it is important to have a basic information about how the body works. So some anatomy, just some basic need to know information about the construction of the body, I think very important. And there's many other books.
And one more question about asana. About obstacles. Sometimes we go through some difficult things, for example, pain, injuries, and maybe we just stuck for a few years with some asana. Do you have your own motivation advice, maybe small secret for keep practicing, for overcoming these obstacles?
It's a difficult one. Every time we have pain, we want to run away.
Yeah.
And when pain comes in the practice, we don't want to do. It's a natural instinct, and it is also very present when we do asana practice. Because when the hamstring is short, we, in the attempt of becoming more healthy and making the body work better, we need to stretch the hamstring. And as soon as we stretch the hamstring, pain is there. So on one hand, we have the possibility to create more health and better ourselves and a deeper understanding. On the other hand, often that path is supported with lots of pain, lots of suffering or some agony or some discomfort at least. Yeah. Now, I think we all have to figure out our relationship to pain and how that goes. But what I found is that my understanding of the positive benefits of suffering and of discomfort and pain has been developed very much from doing the practice, because every day some discomfort is there. For instance, here in Mysore, I wake up 2 a.m. every day. I don't like that at all. Already that is agonizing, already that is lots of suffering, lots of pain. And then I have to go to my mat and be on my mat 4 o'clock. And to start to work my body 4 o'clock, my body would rather sleep or have some breakfast or some coffee or something. So there's a whole world of me looking for a pleasurable experience, and I can't really have it. So how can I exist at a place where I am not in my optimal environment, where it's not just lovely, and then still extract goodness from that place? And I start to feel through the practice, and maybe you agree with me, that there is a deeper sense of pleasure that comes from enduring some of these discomforts and agonies that comes along with the practice. And also with the body itself, I feel we become connoisseurs in pain. We start to very, very detailed know which is good pain, which is bad pain. Which pain should I surrender to? Which pain should I make sure doesn't come close to me? And before that, I was of the opinion that all pain should go away. But some pains are good, some pains are bad. Some pains have a fantastic possibility to give us a lesson, to teach us deeper ideas about who we are, how we react, how we see the world, what we really look for, what we're willing to do to go towards our dreams, and where we will cut short just because it doesn't feel so good along the way. So in my opinion, in my experience, I find the whole notion of pain very, very interesting.
Thank you, Tim, so much for
Спасибо.
Nice conversation.
Can I just say one more thing?
Sure.
Can I say that I am so honored to go to Moscow, to Russia, and teach for the first time. I have never been before. And I look so much forward to meet your students there and to see what you're doing. I know you from Mysore, and I know Dima here from Mysore and more people. So to come to Moscow for me for the first time is a big honor and a big pleasure.
Looking forward to
you too.
See you in Moscow.
See
Thank you.
Thank you.
So much.
Thank you.